Welcome to this week's TDD Weekly Report for the week ending November 29th. This first story is from my friend Tempe. The original story is on NBC News, but I found a better website called Ancient Origins. This is about 5,500-year-old complete hand axe unearthed in prehistoric seabed in Denmark, along with ancient footprints from 5,500 years ago. And what I was really interested in was the bows, and the NBC article didn't show that, but if you go, I'll put the picture up here of the axe, and the neat thing about it is the handle is in just such excellent condition. I don't know how the very top part got knocked off there. Sometimes even when they're doing the excavation or prior to the excavation, this is an area where they were digging a tunnel for train traffic and car traffic in the future, so even when they were doing the original work for the tunnel before they realized they had gotten into something valuable, they could have knocked the top off. They don't really explain here. But the cool thing about it is if you actually scroll down, there is a YouTube video that shows the bows, and the reason why they didn't really show a picture of it, I think, is because the bows are not completely taken out of the clay or the soil, whatever that is there. But you get a chance to see that in the footprints too. As a matter of fact, the link after that, if you look at this video that's on the site, it's in Danish, so it'll be a little bit hard to follow, but I think you still basically can. But I found a link to a video that is in English subtitles, so I will post that down in the link too. But a very interesting article about an archaeological discovery made, and that's how a lot of them are made, actually. They're just construction projects that run into something like this, and the people are smart enough to stop destroying whatever they hit, and then they call them the scientists. So a lot of new information we may get about ancient people and the way they lived. And as usual, all the links will be down in the description below. This next one is from Bob, 1954 Shadow, and this is how the world's first computer was rescued from the scrap heap, from Wired Magazine. The ENIAC, most people would say that the ENIAC is probably the first genuine electronic type of computer, and it actually was a computer based on 40 different panels put together. But when they were done using it in the 1950s, basically they were just tossing it to the side and basically just didn't really care about it anymore. It wasn't of use anymore once the war was over and didn't really need it. But thanks to the millionaire or billionaire Ross Perot, he asked, once they went through the bureaucracy and the paperwork to actually find out where they stored the things, because as usual when the government stores anything to keep it, they end up losing it. But somehow they managed through records and stuff like that to find parts of it, and they agreed to let Ross Perot's people take 8 of the panels to borrow them to do a complete restoration. And for a while they were stored in his offices, which was not really open to the general public, but then that was bought out by Dell Computer, and then Dell agreed to wrap up and ship them all back to be put on public display. And so where you can see them right now, you can see 8 of the panels, and they're not completely totally restored, but they're getting pretty close. You can go to the Fort Sill Field Artillery Museum, which is open 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Tuesday through Saturday, but that would be really cool. The Smithsonian actually has 3 of the panels too, and there are a few of them here and there, but I think the Smithsonian doesn't have them on permanent display. I think they're one of those rotating displays that, depending on when you come to the Smithsonian, you may be able to see them, you may not be able to see them, but this is the greatest chance that if you're in the area, you get to see the what most people would debate would be the world's first electronic computer. Now, if you're a computer geek like me, you know computers preceded even the ENIAC. As you could even go back as far as mechanical computers, like some of the weaving machines and stuff like that. There were mechanical style computers. But yeah, if I ever got the chance and I was in the area, especially since in the future I plan on doing a Route 66 type of trip, I think I'll be close enough that I will definitely be making the effort to get into that area and see that. Definitely something I want to see. And this one is from Catherine S. And a lot of these that I'm posting to, you can also, if you go to the Facebook Dumpster Divers page, which I'll put a link down below too, you can see these too. This is Killer Drone Flight, video of UK's autonomous drone release. This is kind of cool. It looks like a smaller version, especially from the bottom, of the stealth bomber. And I'll put a little bit of the video up here too. But the thing that they're arguing about here too, just like in the case of the American drones, they're getting them so technologically advanced they can put them into a mode where they can do automatic kills with no human being intervening. And some of the people that are concerned about this are wanting to get a preemptive discussion going and some kind of something like a Geneva Convention type of agreement between nations that they will not use this, and it will always be a human being in the loop somewhere before they make the kill decision. Now, as usual, technology doesn't really care about conventions and stuff like that, and I think probably any MIT graduate in robotics and face recognition software could probably cobble together something that was fairly accurate at recognizing people and killing them automatically. So eventually you're just not going to be able to stop it from happening, other than just retribution or something like that. You could have somebody in different regions of the world that are doing some kind of guerrilla fighting or something like that get a hold of the technology and just decide to do that themselves and not really care about any treaties or any international agreements or anything like that. So I think it's definitely something to be very concerned about myself. At least that's my take on it. And I also want to give a shout out to Navy Thomas's channel too, and to Muzzle Mike's channel. They're both seem to be doing a regular shows on different subjects. In the case of Navy Thomas, he's doing topical types of shows on a regular basis. His is called On the Porch, and he's been doing topics in the news about what's been going on, the Ferguson happening in the news, things like that. And I'd like to encourage more people to do like that. I'd like to see more vloggers do a regular, weekly, daily, semi-regular show, something like that. So check out Navy Thomas's On the Porch, and check out Muzzle Mike doing, I think his normal one is called In the Lawn, but now, for obviously for reasons of winter happening, and he lives in Pennsylvania, it's called In the Lounge, so he does it inside. This is a total, complete variety show. And that's kind of neat about it, too. You never know what you're going to get. He might talk about something personal. One time he talked about different guns he owned. Other times he talks about subjects in the news. It's just basically, it could be anything at any time, but it keeps the variety going. And yeah, I encourage these kind of shows, and I encourage people to support these kind of weekly shows. After all, I've been doing mine for 8 years now, and it would be nice to have other people fill in, too. I may not be doing this forever, and it's not likely I'll even be doing it for many more years after 8 years. But for right now, I plan on continuing on, but check them out too, and the links will be down below to their channels. And please subscribe and support them if that's what you're looking for, if you're looking for shows on a regular basis like that. And I would like to close out with something really important I bring up from time to time. This is just a subject that, because of the fact I've come close to losing files in the past, there's nothing better than you can do than back up your files. And if you only have one backup copy, you haven't really backed up your files. So I would encourage people to do like I do. I have an offline backup, I've got the online backup, and then I've got a cloud backup. So I've got three different sets of backups. I've got an automated program every day. It's called Easy Backup, but there's lots of them out there to choose from. That's just one of them. And what it does is every evening after I go to bed, it backs up all my important files to another hard drive that's attached to my computers. Then once a month, I attach a computer that is not normally attached to my computer, and then back up everything that's important to me on that, and then disconnect it again. The reason being is there are viruses out there now that will encrypt your files. They basically don't harm much of anything on your computer, but they go and encrypt all your pictures, all your video files, all your documents, so you don't have access unless you pay them some kind of a ransom or whatever. And so that's not really a cool deal. And then most important of important, if you've got family photos, family videos, anything like that, what I do is I zip them into a large zip file and then upload them to MediaFire. That's just one of many cloud services you can buy. I think it runs about, the plan I've got, they don't offer anymore. It's $29, or I think it's $19 a year. Now they just have a plan for, they got the free plan, which is limited. They've got a medium-sized plan, which is perfect for people, that runs about $50 a year. It's $4.99 a month, but if you pay for the year, you can get the whole year. But there's plenty out there. Just search free online storage, free online backup. There's lots of them out there. Whatever you use, just do it on a regular basis. I would say every day, back up at least the very most important files you have, and then once a month, back them up to a hard drive that is not attached to your computer. You always, and if you don't have the offline storage, what if your house gets in a fire happens in your house or something like that and burns everything up? I mean, at least if you have cloud storage, you have something. So I wanted to mention that before I got off and everything. There is nothing more important than keeping your files, at least in some form that you can retrieve them no matter what happens. And it's not that difficult to do, and it doesn't cost that much. So anyway, that's it for this week. Take care, everybody. I will catch you next week.